You gave me my hands to reach out to men, to show them your love and your perfect plan. You gave me my ears, I can hear your voice so clear. I can hear the cries of sinners, but cannot wipe away their tears. You gave me my voice to speak your word, to sing all your praises to those who never heard. My eyes, I see a need for more availability. I see hearts that have been broken, so many people to be free.
So that you can fill me up. And now I'm free, and I just want to be available to you.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. You are here tonight on the Be For Real broadcast, heard every third Friday of the month. In the studio with me tonight is Danielle, Alana, and Danea. We're going to sit back and relax and just have just what we call a Be For Real discussion. Make believe we're not even on air. We're just going to have a dialogue. And I just have a couple of questions for you guys. And the first question that I have is basically, Speaking to the younger you, you know, if you can go back and say to the younger you, what advice would you give yourself? Because, and the reason why I'm asking this question is because just from observation, I realized that I watched your generation made the mistake that I made in my generation, be it school, be it relationship, be it anything there is. And then I'm seeing the generation coming behind you who are now in college. Believe it or not, that means that y'all are aging a little. And they're making the same generations, same mistakes. And I'm like, I know the generation before me, I know they probably don't like it when I said that, but they were more, they weren't as open. They give you some information to me, but they'll just tell you not to do. But the generation after me wanted, okay, I know you said not to do this, but I need it to be more explicit. Why am I not supposed to do this? Versus my generation, we didn't question them. They just said not to do, and we're like, okay, but we still do it anyway. And we pay the consequence. So you guys are in your mid-20s. I'm going to give you mid-20s. And some are in the start of 20s.
We just started.
So for you guys who have gotten out of college, because Danaya is just entering college. She's in her second year. What advice, because she's the younger you, what exactly would you say looking back? It's like, would I study more? Would I date less? Less partying? What advice? And Danaya, don't laugh because there's a generation right behind you and you've got to advise them because now they're on social media and they're twerking and all of that stuff. And I don't speak that language. So so the younger you, what advice would you have?
So I am in the 30s generation.
Okay.
Moving closer to 40.
Okay.
So what I would say is to be a bit more empathetic.
Mm-hmm.
Understand someone else's perspective.
Okay.
So that when it is time for you to give advice, you're not just judging. You're asking why. You're observing a little bit more. You're not analyzing it in terms of intellectualizing it as in terms of the book. You're looking at what life has to offer, where you live. You're not just saying, oh, I got book knowledge and I'm okay. You have to have street knowledge also. You can't just say, I'm looking at this one perspective and this is what I see. This is a snapshot and it's okay and this is all that I see. You have to look at the whole person, the whole perspective. You know, as a social worker, that's what I look at, the whole perspective. So I'm looking at, if you learn to empathize a little bit better, your perspective deepens. And you don't just see what's in front of you, you look at exactly how people can understand this world a little bit better. So I would tell people, but also learn to observe. Learn to observe and learn to love yourself so that you're not making the same mistakes and question everything that is in front of you, that is in back of you, because if you don't, and it's not necessarily about the reason why, it's about how can I get through it. And that's the only way you're going to learn is if you ask a lot of questions.
That's the one.
I think I would tell myself to slow down. I feel like at that age, I was always trying to get to the next age. Like, I want to know what it's going to be when I'm 21, or I don't know what I'm going to be doing when I'm 25. And I feel like because of that, I wasn't able to really just sit and enjoy and just, like you said, just observe what's going around right then, right now. Instead of always being so worried about how to keep up with the trends and worry about, you know, the next step, where I need to just focus on everything that was going on right then and there. I would definitely just tell myself to slow down. Yeah.
Am I still answering this question?
Yeah, you can answer the question. Because there's a generation right behind you.
I didn't know if I was answering this question. Like, the younger myself is like 9.
No, I mean, you have the 14-year-old. What would you say to a 14-year-old? What would you, or somebody just entering high school?
To be honest, I would honestly say don't take it that seriously. Like, I realized that I took myself way too seriously. Exactly. And, like, I wasn't grown. Like, I don't know. Like, I kind of like Alana said, like, you're always looking to get to the next age because, you know, that was the cool age. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you 14, you're going through puberty, like, your face breaking out. Like, I was just talking to you in the car. I looked at some pictures of me in seventh grade where I wasn't matching clothes. And I was really trying to figure out, like, what was I going through? Like, for me, I think the biggest thing that I learned when I would tell myself is, like, trust the process. Mm-hmm. Is, like, stop trying to grow up and just grow up.
Exactly.
I think that I tried to, like, force myself to be older because, you know, I was always, like, the youngest kid in the group. So I would try to, like, force myself to be, like, grown up, but, like, I wasn't their age. Act your age. And, you know, it's okay to, like, be fun and live your life at the age that you're at.
Exactly.
So, yeah, that's what I tell myself.
Exactly. That's what you say to the younger you. Mm. Mm. So if you can do it all over again, you'll just enjoy the ride.
Yeah.
Exactly.
You know, yeah. You're like, I can't wait till I get 25, yeah, and you get to, like, 25, it's like, okay, what's the, like, big
why
deal?
Why was I rushing? I should have enjoyed 16. I should have enjoyed 18. I should have enjoyed 21. Like,
should have listened.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly. You can't get it back.
No.
You can't. Yeah. You can't have a redo. Yeah. So that's the advice you'll have for the younger generation. Definitely. Enjoy every moment. Enjoy for every stage, because you can't take, you know, you don't get a redo. I can't, you know, live this over. Okay. One of the questions that, do you think my generation, I'm not going to, you know, I can only speak for me, my generation. I can't speak for the generation before me. What exactly are you looking for? What is your generation looking for from us? What are the relationship that you wish that you have with us? Do you think, are we open enough with you? Are we too secretive? Are we in an island by ourselves? Do we help you or we don't? Do you see us as a big sister, or do we boss you around too much, or?
I look at the generation before me and I say, you're closed off and your perspective is closed minded.
Mm-hmm.
You're seen and you're not heard is not something I would like to hear. It's not something I'm going to teach my daughter, who's now 10. We also, you know, the generation before us are grandmothers and great grandmothers. And sometimes they are raising their grandchildren. And so they have to sometimes be closed off. So although it's not the greatest thing to be closed off, it also kind of helps sometimes because they've gone through different situations. That's incredibly traumatic. And so we're not quite sure what they've been through, but they're not opening up because they don't trust. They don't feel comfortable. They don't think you understand what they've been through. So I would hope that they would open a little bit more, not to be as judgmental, and to be able to just respect the person for who they are at their age, and not just say, I'm older, therefore you're going to give me the respect because I'm older. But you also have to understand that the person in front of you also deserves the same amount of respect and understanding, and it needs a conversation sometime.
I totally agree with Danielle. So mine is mixed because I did have some, I was able to have the people around me that were able to, like, keep it real as well. But then I also was able to see people, you know, growing up in church, it's all these aunties and uncles that, you know, were deaconesses and deacons and, you know, sitting next to Jesus. And, you know...
You don't know their struggle.
Exactly. You're right. You don't know their struggle. But a lot of times you feel like you said, like you just had to respect them. It wasn't really not that you didn't earn the respect, but it was just like, you know, I'm the adult, so that's just what it is, you know? Like, and I just feel like once I got older, it was like, wait, so how come you have so many, wait, all those people are your kids, and wait, they don't got the same daddy, and wait, you're not married? But like, it was like, dang, like, you must have been having fun when you were younger, because now that I'm an adult, I can actually, like, I can put two and two together and realize that, okay, but why didn't you show, like, why didn't you actually, like, open up about that, or, like, instead of saying, like, no, don't do that, like, explain why, like, say, like, okay, don't do this because when I did it, this is what happened, or, you know, like, learn from my mistakes as opposed to just saying, like, no, and that's just it, it's no, you know, so.
For me, it's kind of like Alana said, but like I see it differently as in going to college, because, you know, for me, it was like I never knew that so many people in church was in different Black Greek organizations. Mm-hmm. Now going to college and seeing those organizations, and then going back to church and realizing those church people were in those organizations. I now look at you like, but I understand that you had gotten older. And I understand what happens to you when you get older and you mature. And I see how certain Greeks like mature and stuff like that. And that's, I never got that from church. I never got like the experience. I never knew that so many people in my church went to HBCUs. Mm-hmm. I learned about HBCUs through my high school. I never learned about college through church. Mm. I think that's like, that church doesn't prepare you for college in church. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm going to be so honest with you. I did not go to church this semester.
Oh, yeah. That was my whole freshman
because
year.
Because nobody prepared me for Saturday night mm-hmm. into Sunday morning. Mm. Nobody prepared me for the church bus is leaving at 9:30. I'm not waking up that early. But, you know, that was different for me. And, like, learning about, you know, people who went to HBCUs and, you know, you went to my school's rival. I never knew that you went there. You're coming down for homecoming. I definitely want to see you because it's different. And I want to see a different aspect of you outside of church than what I see from you right now. So, yeah.
So you're saying that we need to build more of a relationship, a village, and be more transparent. Yes. So I guess then maybe we should break it down sort of like age group wise. So if you're looking like to the 50 something, like you said, you're in your 40s. Like if you look to the 50 something versus the 60 something or the folks that are in their 70s. One of the things that I'm grateful to God for is like, I had a mentor and she always taught me that you have someone above you and someone below you so that it keeps you in the middle and it keeps you humble. And for that is I had some 30 something in my life and they kept it real for me. They were like, you know, they're now like my nieces or stuff like that or my daughters, and they'd be like, okay, you know, you all tell us in church don't have sex, but you don't give us the reason, can you tell me? And it was around my dinner table on Sunday evening that we'll have those dialogue. So then, you know, and for that my daughter sort of hated because she thinks that I was just too raw. And I said, well, thank the generation before you that, you know, that, you know, that you can appreciate a mother. And she said, Mom, you give us too much information.
Sometimes.
You give us too much information. You are listening to the Beef for Real broadcast heard every third Saturday on Boston Praise Radio. We have a caller that is calling us right now. You can reach out to us at 617-282-7794 or 617-282-0685. Go ahead, caller. We're listening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I'm so happy that these young people are talking tonight. I just have a couple of questions and a couple mm-hmm. of quick comments.
Mm-hmm.
I heard them say something about respecting their elders. And I want to say I had a son and a daughter. We grew up in a Christian home. We went to church. But I kept it for real with them. When my son and daughter went to college, they knew about sex. I sent them condoms. I sent them birth control. They knew what was going on. I didn't hide anything. I taught them growing up in the church that everybody that's calling out Jesus ain't a friend of Jesus. So to be careful in that realm. So all people in the church weren't phony. I kept it real, real with my two children. They knew what I used to do, and I tried to teach them not to do some of the things that I did so that they wouldn't fall in the same kind of pit holes that I fell into. But also, I know for some of these young guys, like the three I see here, they think if I tell you something that I'm judging you. I'm not necessarily. What I'm trying to do is warn you, is to protect you. So every time an older person in my generation, which is in the 60s, I'm in my 60s, when we say something to you, it's because we already know what's coming. And we're trying to protect you from that, not necessarily not let you experience it. And my children can tell you they're not perfect. People thought they were, but my children set them straight right away that they weren't, even though they grew up in a Christian home. They made choices, they made mistakes, and I corrected them without being judgmental. But if you repeat the same mistake again, I'm going to be judgmental. So I just want young people to understand when we say, please don't do this or please don't do that, and we explain why, and you still do it, then I'm going to be a little bit more on the after being judgmental, because obviously you didn't get it or you can't get it. But I understand where you're coming from also.
May
but
I ask you a question?
Uh-huh.
The question is, and I don't know if these three can speak to it, but I know for me personally, and like you said, you're 60, I'm in my 50s, and for me, it takes you having a relationship. Don't be the first time that we're having a conversation is you're scolding me about something. Mm-hmm. I have no respect for you then. And for me, who grew up in a church, it seemingly, that's what the church folks did to us. It was like, there were never lovey-dovey or, hi, baby, how are you doing, or whatever. It's like, I demand certain things because I'm older, mm-hmm. and that's the way I was raised. Just respect your elders. But, you know, they never was there when, you know, you were doing something good and says, oh, I'm proud of you. It was always, your dress is too short, mm-hmm. or this is this. And I'm like, you don't even have a relationship with me. You don't even know my name. You don't even speak to me on a Sunday morning. Why is the first time that you're having a conversation with me is then? I don't know if that's where you guys are coming from. That was my experience.
I don't know. I mean, for me, it was kind of awkward because growing up, everybody knew my parents.
Mm-hmm.
In the sense that I had to tell people, I'm not my parents. Me and my parents have lived two different lifestyles, though I understand that some I get some things from my parents. Just because you know my parents doesn't mean you know me.
Right.
Like, I have people that have told me something. I'm like, you don't even know my major in school. You don't even know where I go to school. I have a lot of people that tell me I go to Spelman. I don't go to Spelman.
Right.
And I think my biggest thing, it was kind of awkward because, you know, going to school, don't have sex, and, you know, growing up in church, sex was a sin.
Mm-hmm.
To like, that's how it was looked like to me, and people would say like, sex is a sin, but you got kids, so how did them kids get there? that was the biggest confusing thing to me.
I just want to say, as a woman of in my 60s, I didn't teach my children that sex was a sin. I gave them birth control. I sent it in their cookie box down to the campus. I had their roommates laughing at, your mom's crazy. No, your mom's smart.
I love
I'm teaching
that.
Them.
I love
yeah,
that.
I wasn't pretending like I right. didn't do that. I did, but I'm letting them know, if you're going to make that choice, right. you need to be responsible for yourself.
Right.
And I also want you guys to understand, is every time an adult or an older person says something to you, you guys shouldn't take it as us being cruel or judgmental. I agree with Marcia when she says we have to establish relationships with mm-hmm. children growing up before we can chastise them. So a lot of children that were around me at my church, I never chastised them. I never gave them any advice unless they asked me. Because the ones that I
You're
did
unique.
Have a relationship with, I was already teaching them, you know, when they were 7, 8, 9, 10 years old, how they should behave, you know, what to watch out for, what to get into, what not to get into. So those children that I personally, and this is just me, if I don't have a relationship with you, I ain't saying anything to you. Unless you ask me, I'm not going to say a word. I can think it, but I would never say it. But if you come to me, then I'm going to be for real. I'm going to tell you the truth. You know, and you might get your feelings hurt, but, you know, I'm for real.
Okay.
That's good.
Thank you, Carla.
We thank you very, very much for your input and continue to listen to us.
I will. Thank you.
Thank you. And continuing our conversation and listening to what the caller had said to us, do you want to add anything to it? She said that she was in her 60s. And for me, I know relationship matters. And I always said that I know my responsibility. I feel, and like I said, I can apologize to you guys that I feel there's areas where I've dropped the ball. Because I know I'm the bridge to your generation, because I'm going to sit with the 60s and whatever and says, this is how I roll. And my generation would think it, but they're not going to say anything to you. The generation after me, no, you're going to get it. So don't think that, you know, you go up to them and says, oh, do this, that they're not going to come back at you. My generation is like, thought about it, don't say anything. They felt just what the next generation is mm-hmm. feeling, but you're going to get it. And then you're going to think they're rude and disrespectful, but you don't have a relationship right. with them. Then you see them come to church every day, but you don't know them. Especially like Danae said, if your parents are not known, no one knows who you are.
Right.
And that shouldn't be in the church. So you know, feeling what you guys have gone through and stuff like that, how do we make some changes? Because I'm also looking at the church and I'm seeing there's a decline as far as your generation in the church. So how do we, you know, how do we bridge that to make you want to be, come back to the village? Come back to the village to be more open, to be more of a partaker in what we're doing. Because, I mean, pretty soon you guys, some of you already started a family, you're going to have a family. Like, basically, like I said, with the, you know, with the young woman that God blessed me with. And I just didn't just do women because I feel the standards for me are the same. So it is for guys. So it is for whatever. Like with my sons, I would like, you know, I have two sons by birth, but I have several sons. And I'd be like, look, by time you realize that a woman is not clean, it's too late. You have a, you know, you have a venereal disease that is, you know, that's incurable. That's why God said not to have sex. Mm-hmm. And you know, I keep it real with them. I said, I have yet to met a person that had sex outside of marriage and don't have any regret. I've yet to meet one. But when you're in the moment, you always think that that's mm-hmm. the person, that's the one, and you're going to spend, mm-hmm. you know, the rest of your life with that person. Because when you're in love, you're just so blind. You're just so blind, and you make silly mistakes. My generation did it. I don't know anything about the generation beforehand. Like I just said, you know, that's like my mother and them. They're very astute, as folks will call them. You know, this, just like you said, you wonder how that these baby comes here. But so whatever, you know. But I'm trying to like keep it real. So like, there's the 14-year-olds that are coming behind. You know, there's your niece, there's your daughters, there's your stuff. So that this, what you've gone through, so that we don't repeat it. How do we go about and bring the changes and bridge it and keeping it real?
I think for me, what I practice when I see the young children in school, or even if I see them in the neighborhood, I give them a hug. Hey, how you doing? What's going on? I'm all right. You know, it starts with a simple, hey, what's going on? How you doing? And eventually what you start to see is they come to you and they'll say, hey, I need a hug today. And I'll say, okay, cool. No problem. What's going on? You know, I think for me, that is what bridged the gap for me at a very young age. A young woman in the church took me under her wing and mentored me for a very long time. And to this day, I still keep in contact with her. And she was just as raw with me as my mother was. But she was able to reach me a little bit sooner.
Can't reach you.
Yes, she was able to reach me a little bit better because also her career field was what I was interested in. She was a police officer. I wanted to be a social worker. And she understood the challenges that I had in my past. And she was able to pinpoint some things. I didn't, you know, agree with her, but I'd say, oh yeah, I got those things going on. And so she was able to help me understand me. And then I was able to then be able to talk to my mother a little bit more explicitly about what exactly was going on and why certain things bothered me. And I would say to my mother, you know what? I really need you to be a little bit more open. Can you just say these things just the way it is and stop giving me what the South would say, what the West Indians would say, give me what it is right now. And I think that for me also helps me to understand these children.
I have released my daughter to a couple of young women in my life. And these are like the young ladies that I've mentored, like listening to them. And I told my kids that you have to thank the young people before you because they were with us. They hung with us and I heard what they had to say as far as, you know, it's like there was some of them that was from the Caribbean that there were certain fields that they had to choose because, you know, as West Indians, you're either going to be a doctor, an engineer, or an attorney. That's it. Or a nurse. That's it. And I was like, oh, no, I can't do that to my kids. Mm-hmm. You know, and some people want to go into music, but their parents did a certain things. Mm-hmm. And it was like, oh, my God. Oh, my God. And, you know, I remember this young man. He was like saying, you know, Miss Marcia, try not to have a baby in later in life where the child is going through puberty and you're going through menopause. It doesn't work in your household. It's just the two just clashes. And they were able to explain that to me. So it's like that village approach. So because of that, I told my kids, you're more fortunate because I, you know, like I sit there, I'm observing, I'm more understanding because I've heard their story. And I allow you to make, you know, I will let you know how I feel about the situation, right. But I'm going to let you know the decision is yours. Mm-hmm. And remember, you've got to live with it for the rest of your life. You will always have my opinion, but you've got to live with the decision that you make. There's consequences, right or wrong, right. And can you live with it?
I think you also got to meet people where they're at, too. I think, like, that was the biggest thing for me is, like, when I had kind of, like, for Alana, I look up to Alana. I ain't even going to lie to you. Because Alana growing up, that's what I saw. Because a lot, like, back in the day when, like, BYF used to be starting, they used to be going everywhere. And we wanted to be them. Mm-hmm. Because that was the youth group that I wanted. And that's what I saw that. And then, you know, it was the step up generation from Alana that was doing, like, back in the day when GMCC had four wins. I was like, man, when I turn 21, what? I'm going to be in four wins. I'm going to have this, and that. Like, I was excited because I saw that, like, you didn't have to be of the world, but you could still have some fun. Mm-hmm. And, like, mm-hmm. I think nowadays mm-hmm. church people don't know how to have some fun. Yes. Yeah. Just have some fun. Like, I, like, for me, like, here we go once more. I thought drinking was a sin, but Jesus turned water into wine, so I didn't understand that. I thought alcohol was bad. It just says not to get drunk. There's rules to follow. I didn't know that. Mm-hmm. And I feel like that's the things that, like, from the older generation, we got to explain some things that just wasn't explained.
And don't get drunk and make sure you can pass a breathalyzer.
Very true. Okay. We have a caller on the line, so we're going to pause that discussion and bring the caller in so we can hear what they have to say to us in chat. Caller, go ahead.
I'm just a caller, but you better not be drinking. My question to everybody on a serious note is, I'm hearing what everybody's saying, but I always hear, and it happens a lot in the black community, that we discuss the issues, but what are the remedies for these issues? I mean, what can we start to put in place for the young lady in the gray and black, I think it is, and the other one next to her with the braids? What can we put into place to start making these things happen that we think about? How do we do that? How do we put it into place?
I think one thing that we should start doing is more mentoring. I don't think that nobody's ever sat there and talked about what happens when you get your first heartbreak. Mm-hmm. Like, what you supposed to do? Right, like, right, honestly, right. Like, in high school, when you in high school and you, like, you feeling somebody and someone break your heart, the church don't prepare you for that.
Yeah, right. That's devastating at that age.
Like, it really hurts
at
your heart.
At that age, it is very devastating.
Daniel, I want you to listen because, you see, you're in your 40s, and it's like, you have experienced, okay, you all experience
true.
Heartbreak.
It is so true.
So how
though.
Do
it's
you
true.
Prepare this? How do you get,
like,
this ready?
Life goes on.
Right. But at that 16? Age, you don't yes. think, you think it's like,
well,
the world.
Can I say this to you all? You get on your knees and pray. Is that the answer you want to hear?
That's part of it. But while you're going through it, you're going through your mind about what did I do
think
wrong?
About praying.
How come this happened? Right. Why, you know? And sometimes you have to understand that maybe you didn't do anything at all. Right. Maybe it wasn't supposed to work. It wasn't the right person at the right time.
The conversation that I had with this young lady once, what I said was, you know, you want to watch the brother from a distance.
Yes.
Because, excuse me, but they won't listen because they thought I was old and I didn't know what I was talking about. Nope. They didn't realize, and I try to say, I've been there. I've done that. Yeah. So let's learn from my mistake so you don't make the mistake. I said, when you're in high school, I said, hormones are running wild.
It's not working.
And you're just, he's just it's sniffing just working. Like a dog.
Right.
And if he don't get you, he's just going to move on.
He's going to move on and keep going.
He's going to go down the whole crew.
Yes,
and he's going to try to take you to the movies and he's going to reach his arms
Same
over.
Same thing happens in college. I just want to say that.
Yep. And but I was, you know, they were at high school. They were at high school. So I was just meeting them where they were at and was like, you know, I was going to take you to the movies and then move on to someone next. And they're like, oh, you know what the person said to me? Oh, you're old. And, you know, back in your day, that was what.
See, that's what I'm talking. All right. So this is the Be For Real broadcast. So I'm going to be for real. So in my household, I wasn't allowed to date till I was 17. Now.
20.
I thought that was the craziest thing in the world when I was 15. But it was just kind of like, honestly, nobody talked about that. Like, what are you dating for?
Right.
For what?
Right. Yeah.
Like I realize this now. I made such a big mistake. Like, it was pointless. Because you're worrying about a relationship. Like, what I should have been worrying about is getting some scholarships. That's what I should have been worrying about.
That's right.
And it was awkward because, you know, we didn't talk about that. And kind of like what Danielle says, there's some things that your mom can say that you just pass. But there's some things that when it comes from a different person's mouth, when you're just sitting down with somebody, you like, man, you right.
Right.
Like, I can definitely say that there are some things that my mentors that I found in church, like sitting in the car with them, riding with them, and us having a conversation, it reached me more than what the way my mom said it. Right. Because, you know, it's your mom.
It's your mom. Right.
And she's saying the same thing.
Yeah,
exact same thing.
A different person.
But you know what? Can I just give you a reality check? It hasn't changed. It's going to repeat itself.
Exactly.
It's going to, your baby's going to do the same thing to you. No, I'm serious. Because you know what? Because my mother said the same thing to me. I'm like, what's she talking about? She don't know what she's talking
about.
And, you know, and what I said to my kids is basically, I'm going to try to be different from my mama because I'm going to allow you to have a conversation with me.
Yeah.
My mother was, I said so, and that's it. Don't ask me no question. I allow you to have a dialogue with me. So I'm trying to be different.
Well, may I interrupt just to ask again? I have not heard what will be the, not solution, because I don't know if we have the solution, but what would be some of the suggestions? I mean, I did hear a little more. I mean, I think this Be For Real broadcast is one of the startup points that, and I would say to your guests, be very for real. Stuff that, you know, use a fake name, even though we see a picture. Use a fake name and try to be for real. Thank you, ladies, and you all have a wonderful evening.
I said mentoring, I don't know.
How about if you meet with your pastors? Do you think, are they willing to sit down and listen to you? We have a pastor behind the scene. Would you be willing to listen to your young people as far as what they want to implement in the church? Remembering that you did the same thing back in the 60s. I know they weren't willing to listen to you then, but as far as certain things that you want to get started, would you be open to your young people saying, I want to do stuff like Danae was saying that she looked forward to, like the BYF, for like a Four Winds,
missed
and the
out.
Four Winds are no longer there. So how do you bring back the Four Winds to replicate what they were doing and pass the baton on to you so that church will be fun and you won't be at the club getting your groove on?
And why can't you folks start the Four Winds?
Because there's no background behind it. Like, I remember there was one time where I tried to have a get-together. And I was told, y'all need to end by 10. Nobody wants to be, like, 10 o'clock is so early.
Right.
Like, I'm going to use y'all as an example again. When they used to go out, they used to be coming back at 4 in the morning.
Yeah, but then I'm gonna throw it on Danielle, because then I'm looking up to her, okay?
Stuff was like, our youth pastor kept us out till after 2 o'clock because he didn't want us to go to the club.
Right.
So he had us hanging till that late.
Mm-hmm.
So we don't know a youth group. Our 10 o'clock, our youth group is just getting started.
Exactly.
We're just getting started.
Exactly.
He hang out till 2 o'clock in the morning because he didn't want the club to be.
That's right.
You won't be at the.
Okay, caller, go ahead. You're on the air. We're listening to the Be For Real broadcast.
Hello, ladies.
Hi.
Hi.
I have a question for you.
Mm-hmm.
In your conversation, you talked about just your own experiences about how you looked up to the young people that were in the church and how you kind of emulated them or trying to, you know, you had role models that you look forward to. In the church now, right now, you don't see as many young people. Mm-hmm. And so my concern, I would like to hear from you, is how can we, because we've got few young people, but they don't have those mentors or those ones that are not in the church. How can we get them in the church and then keep them there so that we don't lose any generation?
I think it's...
Go ahead.
Sorry. I think the church needs to be relevant.
Okay.
I feel like the church is so stuck on tradition. And I mean, I think it's tradition is needed. Hymns are needed. But I feel like we need to be within the time that we are in right now.
Mm-hmm. Mix it.
I think the church has a hard time with moving from the past and how that pastor used to do it, or that minister used to do it, or that pastor emeritus used to do it. So I feel like until we change that, I don't really know, because I'm going to say so myself. I haven't really been to church that much in a while. Mrs. Brown can tell you, Danielle can tell you, because I haven't really been sitting there. So, I mean, yeah, we just got to find a way to stay relevant and with the times.
Mm-hmm. I don't necessarily need to. I think that it doesn't have to happen within the four walls of the church. Yeah. It can happen at a school. It can happen at a community center. It can happen at a skating rink. Wherever people are, that's where you go. And it doesn't need, not a lot of people want to hear about Jesus. Sometimes they want to feel your spirit, but they don't necessarily want to hear about it. And then when you have opened them up and allow them to observe you and to see you at a distance and see how you speak with them and talk with them and get their perspective, then you're going to be able to reach them. But you have to be able to be at their level. I'm a social worker, as I said, and so I go into people's homes. And the reason why they started to do in-home therapy is because they wanted social workers to get out of the office and go into people's homes. So when you're in people's homes, you're going to see a bug. You're going to smell crack cocaine. You might smell, you might see somebody, you may see a needle in the corner. But that doesn't mean that you stop providing service because they're not at that level where you need them to be.
I think that conversation needs to be the broadcast is just so short, but I think that this conversation needs to be taken further into the church. Like, sit down on a Saturday and it's like, the next generation, can you listen to what we have to say? Right. Listen to our advice. And like the caller before that is saying, okay, we've had these conversations before. When we're going to put some legs to it? When am I going to bring you alongside me and says, walk in my shoe? Like you said, don't judge you. So after we get off the air, I would like to know what our next step is after just sharing this, because we're putting this out there. And where's the buy-in?
I think my thing, it also starts with a greeting. I think the biggest thing that I got from my church down in Savannah, when I went, I did go to church at least once, was the fact that, like, the church used to send me a text message at 8:00 every single Sunday morning. And it got annoying, but it was fun at the same time. And I think when I was younger and BYF used to be a little bit more fast-paced, when I used to tell people used to ask me, oh, you want to go to the movies? I'm like, nah, I'm going out with my church right now. And they're like, church is going to the movies? I'm like, yeah, we about to go party. We about to go have some fun.
Yeah.
And I remember there was one time where we were laughing so hard. I don't know where we were. And somebody was like, who are you guys? And we said, oh, we're the church. Right. And someone was like, the church gets out like this? Mm-hmm. Mm. And I think that what some people got to realize in the church is more than just Sunday.
Right.
It's not a Sunday service. Church is not, 9 to 2. Like, when I heard that my church was going to Maine, I'm like, Maine, I had so much fun with the older generation. I didn't think I was going to have. It was amazing.
Right. Like, oh, they went to Maine?
Yeah, it was fun. We had lobster and everything, and we had fun. That's right. And that's more than just a Sunday and seeing and sitting in a pew after Sunday service and talking.
Right. I heard the younger generation is the younger generation that is calling back for the retreat. We did a retreat a couple years back.
Oh, that retreat was off the hook.
We had so much fun. It was good.
And they're asking for this. So we're looking to bring it back in 2018 and plan it around when the young folks that were young folks are now in college are home.
Right.
Because it was like they get to see you in a different light. Mm-hmm. So they realize that for me, I'm later for the stuffy shirts or whatever coming here. Like you were saying, Danielle, meet people where they're at, and then they'll find out later that you're a Christian. Exactly. I'm serious, because even at the workplace, they're like, there's something different about you, but you're down to earth.
Right.
Like you said, don't throw Jesus at them. Just live the life in front of them.
Have fun. Play spades with each other. Like, you know, game night was great to see people that I normally see in usher's uniforms yell at me at a spades game. I'm looking at them
like, oh, snap, like, okay. Like,
that's where the relationship starts.
Yeah, right. Absolutely.
Yeah.
And having fun and, you know, doing stuff like that. And like you said at the retreat, seeing somebody in their pajamas right. is a lot different than seeing you in a dress. Right. And, you know, it's like, you know, this is your lowest lows. You can't go nowhere for this. With a bonnet on, okay. That's where I want to talk to you.
That's right.
It's not yeah. always on a Sunday. Church is more than just Sunday. Yeah. I think that's what I would say take from that.
Okay.
Well, thank you, ladies. I just encourage you to keep your heads up and slow down and enjoy your life like you're doing. Because life is, you know, not promised, and every day is a gift. And each of you have done a lot with each of your roads that God has placed you on, and I just pray that you continue to look to him, carry him, abide in him, hold on to him, and God knows he's going to take you all beyond anything that you could dream of. So thank you.
And for the next step caller, we'll be looking to you for some help also. Okay, thank you. Thank you for calling. But that's what it is. Okay, so like there's the next step. Okay, because Danaya, like you said, there was the Alana. Alana looked up to Danielle. Danielle, you looked up to my generation. And okay, and for us, we're like, okay, what happened? Because there's a generation coming behind you, and it's like it's getting fewer and fewer and fewer in number. And I'm realizing that we're dealing with an unchurched generation. Like when I look in the schools, it's like on Sundays, these kids don't know what church is all about. All they know is their football game and all these activities that they do. So there's like three generation that is removed. So like you said, the marketplace is different now. Mm-hmm. So we probably need to be like, let's go take church on the football, you know, take it out to the football field one Sunday or whatever, or what we would be different is, there's some of our kids that play sports. What would be a great witness to go out there on a Sunday and bear witness and come with just a shirt on saying that you belong, or you don't even have to have a shirt. The simple fact that you just sit in a corner and pray. Mm-hmm. And then we're like, okay, why are they praying?
Right.
And there's an opportunity there to witness God.
I think definitely for the younger generation, I think the biggest thing to me is when one of the church members said, hey, like, make sure I get your schedule for this season. And I'm like, you coming to my game?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Like, the fact that you took time out of your day to drive to where I go to school to watch a game where, like, my softball team was terrible. I'm just going to say it now. Like, you sat there and watched us lose. That made me feel better.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Our youth pastor, we had to give him our report card, and he can pop
out
of school.
I don't
want to
do that no more.
No. Anytime. That was, like, the relationship that he had with us. You know, like, he show up. Anywhere, you're like, Jesus, you know, but even then you didn't appreciate it until you got older. It was
also, money for report cards is a great thing. It's a great initiative.
Your pastor do money for
I'm
report cards.
I'm just letting you know. Like, honestly, if you want to reach the next generation, money is a great way to do it.
Your pastor did that. I am.
Listen.
I don't know.
$1 for AIDS.
I'd like to go to the homes of the young people if they didn't show up for the youth group. And I knew it was a boyfriend and girlfriend. Neither of them came to the youth group. Ooh. I'd go to the house.
Uh-huh.
And many times I would find that they were stupid enough not to lock the door. I would walk in and bust them. You hear what I'm saying? That's all.
Because if he's your youth pastor, you know what he's capable of doing.
That's right.
You know, he just show up anywhere in your life.
Hello.
Okay, turn the line off.
He was just too inquisitive for us, you know, as our youth pastor. Yeah. He was always in your business. Just always in your business.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, keeping it for real on the Beat for Real broadcast. You can hear us every third Friday.
We're going to do a broadcast entitled Marcia Brown, This Is Your Life.
True life.
True life. Church. Well, you know, I keep it real because, you know, like I explained to the young folks in my life, my experience. Like, basically, like I said, you know, like my mother, she didn't break it down. She was like, mm-hmm. basically saying, you know, you couldn't date till you were 17. Of course, she didn't explain why. Right. I found out why. And then, you know, she West Indian. So she's like, you're now 17. You're heading to school. You don't need a boyfriend. Okay, mm-hmm. Really? What are you talking about? You gave me the license then. But what she meant was, I told my kids or the young folks that I'm able to mentor that basically I didn't listen. And then when I got to college, I had a breakup. And it, my grade plummet because I, you know, for 6 months. Mm-hmm. That's keeping it for real. Mm-hmm. And that's why they don't want you to get involved. So when my young adults were heading to college, I was like, look, just observe the brother from a distance. Right. And they don't listen. They come back and tell me later, you know what? You were right. And I was like, and that's what I'm saying. We're making the same mistakes over and over.
I got one more thing. As a young girl, I think the biggest thing for me and for any older women is that talk to these young girls mm-hmm. about inner beauty. Yes. I think that the biggest thing that I've seen working in the summer camp that I work at mm-hmm. is that the girls that I work with don't know their inner beauty. And right. you are so much more than that. Yes. And that, you know, I understand not dating till 17 and stuff like that. But, like, it's kind of hard, like, you know, don't have a boyfriend. But you also got to tell people boys are still going to be there
right.
when
right.
you're in school. Right. And that.
They ain't going anywhere.
There is so much more right. than just your body that right. needs to be respected. Mm-hmm. And I think it was so hard for me to understand. Everybody says, oh, he needs to respect your mind. What does that mean? Mm-hmm. Like, what did that, I don't think that, like, that's what, if you want to mentor somebody, make sure you mentor them that way. Mm-hmm. That, like, you are so much more beautiful on mm-hmm. the inside. Mm-hmm. It don't matter what you look like. Right. And if somebody calls you ugly, forget them and right. keep going. And the group of friends that you hang out with is going to change no matter where you go. Like, I've said from personal experience, I've hung out with the worst people. And that you got to learn, if you're sinking, you're not, like, the people that you're with are pulling you down. Mm-hmm. And you've got to cut ties with those people and see how your life grows without them. Mm-hmm. And it's okay to be by yourself. Mm-hmm. And one of my friend's moms had said the greatest thing to me when I was on the phone. And because we were talking about boyfriends and girlfriends. And she said, I don't understand why you're looking for somebody to complete you. You can't even complete yourself. Mm. You've got to complete yourself before you go out looking for somebody. Mm-hmm. And I think that was the biggest thing for me is that the reason why I wanted to date at 17. Because you always thought that when you had somebody, they completed you. That's not what they're there for. They're there to help you.
Okay, so the question that I have for all three of you, after tonight, can I hold you accountable that you will definitely, for sure, have a mentee in your life?
Yes. Oh, yes.
Beyond sure. the ones that you already have?
Yes.
Okay, like someone that you, like, okay, you know, like I said to folks, I can't reach everybody. Right. But I know that I just said to God, place the people in my life right. that you want me or the person to mentor to or whatever. So right. you need, and what I was told is, you find your mentor. Right. Your mentor don't find you. Right. Because you have to observe the person, watch the way they live, watch what they do and don't do. And it's like, do I want to be a part of this? Like, my mentor mm-hmm. can't be a person that's into gossip and all of that stuff right. and right. think that they have to, like, because that's not what I'm about. Right. So I'm going to watch your lifestyle. I know you're not perfect.
Right.
And then when you finally get a mentor, they're going to open certain parts of their life to you. Right. It's not for you to air it out there. Exactly. It's just they got to be transparent to you for you to see what life lesson is all about.
Right.
So I've always said to folks, when you're looking for your mentor, ask God to send the person because God will. Your mentee, you're normally, I ask God to send them too. Mm-hmm. And, you know, right now I was like, you know, there's some of them that are still running. And I was like, okay, I'm not chasing you. When God lock you down and when, you know, when you're back up against the wall and you've got to turn right. back around and be like, I've been waiting all along. Right. I've been there. So I'm going to leave here adding to my mentee plate y'all gonna find yourself a mentee, and I'm gonna check back in with you guys. What did you think about the broadcast? I thank you guys for being here. It is so short and sweet, but I would like to continue this conversation and add more of a roundtable dialogue. That way we can bring in the adults, bring in the folks that makes the decisions and the places that makes the decisions, so we can see the changes that we would like to see.
That'll be really good.
Again, you've been listening to the Be For Real broadcast, heard every third Friday of the month on Boston Praise Radio and TV. In the studio with me tonight was Danielle, Alana, and Danaya. Peace.
Good night.